Good morning and welcome to our monthly webcast. I am Samir Mehta, your moderator, and this is session number 102. We tout as showing truly complex coronary interventions on this webcast, and for you today, we have an elderly 88-year-old female who has severe impairment of left ventricular function with the ejection fraction less than 20%, marked and pronounced calcification and unprotected left main bifurcation. I truly believe it cannot be more complex than that. Let's show you many teaching tips and tricks. With this introduction, let me take you to the cardiac catheterization laboratory. Sameen, yes, good morning. Appropriate description of this highly complex
case? Absolutely.
You were waiting to do this for the last case of the year.
That is...
leave the hardest for the last.
Yeah. Yes, we'll just go through that. Yeah, 1 second, take a picture and then we'll go back.
My compliments to the patient, really. I walked into the room before the case and she does not look her age at all.
Yes. All right, with that note, let's start while they're getting ready. And good morning to all our viewers for our 102nd episode of CCC Live. And thanks for the support, which is monthly now, about 10,000 views per month, which is, we want to be more active also, so they can ask questions. But anyway, overall, it has been a great educational format, and everywhere we go, got a really thumbs up for the services which we are providing and type of the cases we are selecting, and more importantly, procedural steps, as well as the didactic discussion. These are our supporters. Disclosures, no change. Now, this is an 88-year-old patient who presented, had actually BMS to LAD about 7 years ago, and now presented with worsening dyspnea. Did not have any, little bit of chest pain, but more dyspnea. And echo showed fall in EF. Last EF was 55, and now became 25%. Cardiac cath on November 28 revealed calcific two vessel and left main disease, which Dr. Keeney will show, and to show that.
Okay, let me just finish the right.
Okay.
Right was non-obstructive.
Yes.
Just we're going to show you engaging of the right.
Yeah.
Can the first note the calcification very pronounced.
Yep.
Don't do the left, right?
No, no, but you do the right, but
okay,
I'm saying.
Okay, here, one picture, okay. Done.
All right, so this will be the right first.
Inject.
Very mild large, diffuse, nice dominant vessel.
Now you have to go to the ventricle, we'll go.
Yeah. So if you see a distal left main involving ostial LAD and also ostial circ.
Yeah,
so the reason she was sent, you mentioned, right?
So then, so, change so in the therefore, EF. Low ejection fraction. So after this, with the age and LV function, actually EF now showed 19% on echo. So clearly, the because of all the factors, we recommended patient should have a surgical consultation. They wanted a viability, which we did. And patient, we actually also did IVUS at the time because there was some question whether how tight it is. Clearly, left main has a very significant lesion. We'll show it again today. And the patient was optimized on heart failure and anti-ischemic therapy. But at the same time, also has a stress thallium to see both viability as well as ischemia, which showed global ischemia in all the territory, as well as viability in the anterior, inferior, and lateral wall. So patient good in terms of optimized medical therapy, and brought here for this purpose today with the syntax score of 24.
So even the investigators for the Orbita trial would have no issue with this case.
This case will be excluded, as you well know, with that left main disease, multivessel, and this actually is a kind of two vessel, and so. So we're going to take a little bit, quick picture.
EDP?
EDP is good. Okay.
Actually five.
Yeah.
Okay, ready?
Yeah.
LV?
Yeah.
Inject.
Yeah, so I think anti-ischemic therapy have brought it maybe around 25 to 30 now. It was 19 by echo, as well as by thallium was 22. So it was in that range and now reaching probably 30. So while because of in this particular case, I was showed a significant lumen obstruction of the left main.
You're ready?
And today is the plan for IVUS guided protected PCI of unprotected left main, bifurcation utilizing rotablation because of calcification, and impella, hemodynamic support, and dedicated two stent technique. Yeah. So now, while Dr. Keene is going to put an impella, we'll just go over our lecture,
so
get some time.
Sameen, before, yeah, before you go into that, quick question. There is a question coming from India.
Yes.
We do not have an impella catheter. Could a balloon pump substitute?
Absolutely, yes. And I was just there with the Sky meeting in Mumbai. Was very, very, I would say, the big hit. 800 interventionalists were there. And more than 50% actually were 10 year in practice.
Fantastic.
So this was a big, big hit, and we talked about it. And I can tell you that we are talking about impella. You know, impella was used in India a long time ago, but at present with the DCGI, and hopefully we expect within first or second quarter of 2018 that we'll have an impella in India, although cost will be a little issue. But, you know, as long as we have the device available, we should be able to have whatever the latest in the technology available. But yes, in that case, I would have no calm about using the just the balloon pump in this particular case.
Excellent.
So now,
just for our viewers' recollection, case number one CCC live cases used the impella catheter almost 9 years ago.
And in between, we have now you actually have tagged also. You know, a lot of people came during this meeting in Mumbai, and they said that they're very happy that we have tagged our cases, whether it's a left main, calcification, bifurcation, and so on and so forth. So that has been a good resource. So rather than looking through all, the tagging is working very good.
Wonderful.
So, and Sameer, I thank you for that, because you are working with that, with Kim, and making them appropriate. And particularly biggest interest of the people are calcific left main and bifurcation lesions and retrograde CTOs. Those are the really the big highlights.
Anu, a very quick, we saw it online, straightforward insertion of the device.
It was not straightforward, it was tortuous.
But
I mean, we did have some resistance just in the iliac.
Yes.
Right,
so
okay.
Yeah.
But wow, the crossing the LV went very smoothly.
Yes. Yeah.
Any teaching tip how to do that?
Oh, for the crossing of the LV with the JR catheter?
Yes.
Nothing. You could either go RAO, LAO view, whichever. And I think there's nothing, no technique in getting in.
Straightforward, simple, easy insertion. And now you're going to go up the grading, starting with the level one?
Yeah. You can show there. And it, hello, focus on the impella. Get us a VL guide. Yeah, yeah. So far, so good. Nothing is showing.
Okay, we see that very nicely. It's up to 2.0 liters, 2.1.
Yeah, yes,
and
good.
This was a 2.5 you used, no?
Yes, this is a 2.5.
And what French is it now?
13 French sheath.
All right.
And if you go to the bigger one, bigger, 14.
So, Anu, you probably have one of the largest experiences with the device. How come we are still in 2018 struggling with the 13 French?
That they need to ask the company, I guess.
Right.
Because the motor is the motor.
Constraint behind
it.
Yeah,
the size of the motor needs that. The
all
catheter
right.
itself is like 9 French.
Let me engage you in a little conversation as before Dr. Sharma starts the presentation. What do you see is the biggest challenge in this case?
Oh, this challenge here is, I think the stenting technique of the left main.
Okay.
Yeah. What technique we are going to use, number one, I think we still will go with a plan is mini crush.
Okay. Sameen, ready for you and...
Absolutely. So we go while they're getting ready with the IVUS site. We'll come back to you when the IVUS of the left main will be done.
You have an ACT?
So we can go back to our slides. I corrected that earlier to 2010, 55 to 22% now. And we'll change that on the slide. And this
perfect.
Basically is now with the IVUS guided protected PCI. So clearly heart team discussion, that is what the important point in this case. And then this is the unprotected PCI left main with a moderate complexity of one or two vessels, not multiple vessels. And this will be M, because PCI will never be for left main, despite we have shown on the Excel trial, will be a class one or appropriate yet. I believe that if the Excel really showed that 5-year data equivalent, then maybe they will become appropriate also in patients with a syntax score of 32 or below. But we are still waiting for that guidelines. We don't expect to change, but clearly the maybe the ostial and the proximal or mid shaft can become appropriate. As you can see here on the top, which is the isolated left main, the shaft disease, and they could be appropriate even for the PCI.
Go from the vein there.
Okay, now also with the bifurcate app, which we popularized since our October at the 100th webcast, the clearly we, you know, the starting in the bifurcate is whether you are left main lesion or non-left main lesion, because that's where the decision comes down. And clearly, the most important being the decision of the left main is that if you have true bifurcation, which is 111 or 011, it really will be that you have two-stent approach like this particular case. Now, we also know the data, that the data in the Excel trial was 80%+ were distal left main bifurcation, but single stent was used in 60% of cases. But that could be 100. We had a discussion about that recently. So those, the what was seen in the Excel, we still need to see whether two stent versus the provisional stent technique could be enough. But I believe that once you have 111, that not only distal left main only, but distal left main going into the both ostial LAD and ostial circ, which is 111, or little bit distal left main narrowing, but both ostial LAD and ostial circ, which is 011, and that is a part of the DK Crush 5 trial, which we showed last month. So those cases should have a dedicated two-stent approach. Why? Because once you go with the one-stent approach, which is the provisional, almost half of the time, you'll end up putting a second stent. And to me, that is actually gives the bad results. You saw it all the event in the DK Crush in the provisional stent group happen in those 47% of cases where two stents were used. So clearly, we should go with the two-stent approach. And this is what we have in our bifurcated app, in the distal left main Medina 111. We don't even have the provisional stent as an approach.
Absolutely right in pointing to the trial, but in more than 35 or 40 similar cases, I have never seen you ever use a single stent.
Exactly. So I think the single stent, when people are proponent, I have nothing wrong about it. And we had a big discussion about this, as I mentioned, even recently in the Sky meeting. The key is, you have to decide what your distal left main is. We know majority of the cases of the left main are distal left main, which are about 80% or 75% of cases. But is this 100? That's a different. There, I think one stent approach could be okay. But if it is 111 or 011, those cases, in my opinion, are not good for the single stent approach.
Got it.
Okay. Now, with that note, while we are getting ready with the pictures and so, you saw a little, we needed to change the guide. We put a 7 French VL3.5. VL3.5, and we 2 points I'll talk today about the depth duration after complex PCI and update in transradial intervention in the United States. You know that always I try to bring the latest which has come into the literature. So first is the depth duration. And remember what has happened over the years. In the past, we used to worry about more of the thrombosis, but now with the second generation stent, we're learning that that is less of an issue, bleeding is more. And therefore, that equipoise, that what is the cutoff? You can continue. After taking a picture, do the IVUS. Yes.
No, we have a picture now. We don't want to.
No, but do the IVUS in RAO caudal or so. So, key remains is that what should be the depth duration? Because longer the duration, we know, is the more is the bleeding. Early time, more ischemic benefit, then there is an equipoise, and then long duration, which is good. But can cause more bleeding. And we also learned that long duration of depth at present or even in the old stent DEP trial, half of the benefit came from decreasing restenosis, or decreasing stent-related event. But other half, by decreasing the spontaneous MI and acute coronary syndrome from a non-stented vessel. So clearly, the prolonged antiplatelet therapy in these complex PCI patients could have benefit both, not only for the stent, but also for the native vessel and so. And this is what led to the final guidelines, 6 months for stable patients, 12 months for unstable acute coronary syndrome patients, and they do actually mention that you can give prolonged DAPT in some cases, and that is based on the DAPT score. And they use the DAPT score in there, because this is what we put editorial, that once you go beyond 1 year, it's the bleeding, which is the red, is more important than the myocardial infarction. So so clearly, the issue remain about the DAPT score and so is very important. So now, this is what part has been. Now, what has we shown earlier this year, that the data from multi-center registry, that once you have complex PCI, and we're defined as more than three lesion, three vessel, three stents, or 60 millimeter, or bifurcation and CTO, that clearly you see the long DAPT, which is versus short DAPT. The short DAPT with the complex cases with the height of the blue bar,
okay, start.
Significantly higher event rate compared to the short DAPT, and so. So this basically led to that more complex features, long DAPT will be beneficial. So with that note, we can stop here. One second. Yeah, so we are going back to the IVUS.
Okay, right there. Okay, there. You got the bookmark, right?
So you want to make a point now?
Okay, this is the left main. Okay.
Yeah, so IVUS has been done for the left main.
Okay, shows just that. So you see the stent in the proximal LAD, right? Yeah. Keep pulling back. Pull back. Yeah, and this is the ostial LAD left main there. Yeah.
No, but you had the very tight lesion earlier.
Yeah. Just move with the cursor.
Yeah, good. One frame. Yeah, see that? Full 300 and not 60, maybe 340 degree calcium.
Do trace
full
assist.
Full arc of the calcium. No, but I'm saying for the calcium point of view,
yeah.
Little interruption. Very tight lumen now actually is 4.1. It was 5.16 before.
No, that's left main. This is ostial LAD.
LAD.
This is left main.
But very calcific lesion. They are good. That's fine.
So yeah, the calcification is clearly not a surprise. It was evident even on the 175.
Yeah. Give me the rotavire.
Or do you want to make with this bar? You want
Good.
You want to see it? The question is whether do you use a 2-0 bar?
No, see that 1.96
yeah,
one diameter.
There. Yeah, which is good. So then 2-0.
Want to go 2-0?
Yeah, 2-0. Single bar. Yeah. The question was whether 1.75, you want to just review the angiogram once again?
Sameen, what is your thought process going with the larger bar straight away?
No, but I think the point is you want a little bit of the modification. The if the lumen is already 1.9, whether 1.7, even with the eccentric cut, is going to do anything. Mm-hmm. That's the issue. Mm-hmm. So just because of that. So question is, we don't want to go to big bar size, but you all still want something that is going to do the plaque modification. If you really have a small bar, so you are done.
The circle.
Yeah, you do want to do the IVUS of the circ?
Let's finish the
Yeah, should we do the IVUS of the circ? That was the question.
Probably not needed, really.
No. We just take care of both.
Yeah, let's proceed.
Yeah.
Many challenges ahead.
No, but let's see. If we analyze the IVUS of the distal left main, mm-hmm. is there a, what can we see? When we did last time, there was just a mild disease, mild to moderate disease at the ostial surf. You want to just see the side branch from the left main?
Cannot.
No, but we do. But see, even there, distal left main bifurcation. Ostium, if we can see.
I think multiple wiring, doing this, you need to avoid. Just take this out. Clean the IVUS.
Open the 2-0.
No, you cannot. Based on this, you need IVUS of the side branch also.
Yeah. So, but can we have some idea by the angiogram? No.
Angiogram you want?
Yeah, no, but by angiogram, but if you analyze that, there is always appear that moderate lesion
Are you thinking about single strand?
No.
It is 50%. Yeah. So I guess.
Yeah, so there is, no, but unless you go there, yeah, you cannot see.
Yeah, you cannot.
Yeah.
You have to IVUS into the circle.
Even with the angiogram, maybe at some stage a little caudal. Sameen, go ahead.
Okay. All right, we go back to our presentation. So then, what is the DAPT score? Mm-hmm. And that basically is the variable of patient's age, cigarette smoking, diabetes, MI presentation or prior MI or PCI, or paclitaxel eluting stent because those had a higher thrombosis, stent diameter less than 3, LVEF less than 30, and vein graft stent. So all these gives you the score, and 2 and above has a high risk of thrombotic events. So prolonged DAPT is indicated. So problem with the DAPT score is it doesn't give into consideration of much of basically the bleeding. It does give you very good assurance in terms of the long-term MACE, but not necessarily for the thrombotic factors. So this actually, put it together, you can see
Note
here, lower score versus higher
Note
score, 2 versus more than 2. So if you take the score less than 2, if you see that short DAPT or long DAPT, so short DAPT is in the yellow and in a purple is the long-term DAPT. So if you see here, long-term DAPT actually cause more bleeding if your score is low. So therefore, in those cases, your lower DAPT score of 2 or below, you should be able to give only for short term, 12 months or maybe even lower. But if you have a high score, you can see there clearly that the long-term DAPT really reduced the event MACI and not much difference in bleeding. So clearly the very good tool. And now, as of last week, we are incorporated, and this is in the guideline of our December with the paper which I shared with you. So therefore, we have incorporated that in our cath reporting system, and we tell the physicians, cardiologists, that if the score is 2 or below, we say unfavorable for long-term DAPT. If 2 and above, it comes out favorable for long-term DAPT. So what I also shown in the same data, that if your complexity and outcome of the DAPT duration, basically, they call complex lesion of the left main, more than 2 lesion per vessel, lesion length more than 30, bifurcation as vein graft and thrombus containing lesions, and showed that clearly that the patients who these complex cases, based on the characteristics, you have higher the complex characteristics, higher is the MACI event rate, as you can see there, although there was no difference in bleeding. But at the same time, that those are the patients, as you can see, that the more ischemic event occurs, and if you take it based on the DAPT score, and you can see there, complex or non-complex, what it come out to be in this study, that after 12 months, whatever event happened, patient then were randomized just a continuation of aspirin versus continuation of clopidogrel for another 18 months, it showed basically that based on the DAPT score, you have a higher event rate in the complex as well as in non-complex cases. So therefore, it gives the precedence, credence to our, what? It gives the credence to really our DAPT score in using into our day-to-day, and that is what we have started doing. So clearly, it shows that complex lesion better off by getting a long-term DAPT here. So there is another score, Paris score, which is a separate both for the bleeding as well as for thrombotic event, and that has shown good the overall histogram. Basically, the higher the score, higher is the bleeding or the MACI. So there are many of them. So just to sum it up, so I think we know that 6 months is the ideal. Some cases you can make it less than 6 months. Patients are going to bleed, and longer, 1 to 3 years or longer, patient with the complex intervention and diabetes and prior MI and so. So more importantly, this field is also evolving that bleeding probably occurs because of the aspirin. So whether you take aspirin for 1 month, which is the leaders global, or 3 months, which is the twilight, leaders global has been completed. Twilight is about 2/3 completed, and we'll know the data that when can we change it to a single antiplatelet therapy. With that note, I think I'll stop here because Anu is ready now.
Yeah,
with
we could hear the sound of the burr.
Yes, they're ready, go. It's a 2-0 bar we have selected.
Okay.
2-0 bar, yeah.
Okay.
So we did a direct wiring of the LAD with the rotavar. Same. I think if you have any difficulty, you can use this rota clip to negotiate the wire through the lesion. Since this was moderate disease, I would say 70%, 80%, you can use the rotavar. If you think you cannot, then you use any over-the-wire device, use your regular wire, and then exchange to rotavar. Pull back the wire.
So the and wire is looped, that's
yeah,
okay.
Pull back, a little bit, pull back.
Three-step preparatory technique, Anu.
Yes, yes. Yeah. Same thing in the left main now. Good. See that? You have a large left main non-disease, three steps. Okay, move it. Same, you move the knob, then your Y connector backward, forward. I mean the body of the left main and the tap, done, off dyna, and start going. Slow pecking motion, same. Forward and back, forward and back. Blood pressure is good, stable, no EKG changes, good. Even this was like nothing, right?
Yeah. Good. So now, also we made some changes, and I think we need to keep everybody updated. We stopped putting the verapamil and nitroglycerin, an additional heparin in our flush bag. It's only the rota glide. And that has created a less, less need for pacemaker.
Wow.
So we are coming with a consensus document so that you're done.
Good decision to use a 2-0.
Yeah, it could have been even 2.15, but 2-0 is good.
Can we see the, the hemodynamics and the impact of the Impella? How much is the cardiac output at the moment? Patient has clearly tolerated extremely
2.2.
Well. Yeah, we are seeing the screen, but not the
hemodynamics being shown.
Yeah. If we can show the.
Yeah. No, but right now we are taking it out.
Okay.
That's fine.
Soon we will have a three channel. So we'll be able to show three things.
Excellent hemodynamics.
Yeah. And we have to find out when we start showing those three. So we leave that. I don't think we need for the circumflex anyway.
So this was the precise moment during which I think left ventricular support device kicks in.
But I think real
stenting,
will be
during
when
the
we are doing the bifurcation
stenting.
Technique.
Stenting,
yeah.
Right.
Yeah. So that will be the real one.
Okay. Looks good.
Is okay. No, he pushed back. It was getting.
And coming back to the size. What you asked earlier, so Samir, I have seen the prototype, they go to 11 French.
Yeah.
So, but 11 French is the lowest they have.
It's not in the apex.
And they are trying to do, also that's okay right now, we are epicranial. So, that looks that way.
Otherwise.
So, let's put the two wires over quickly. So, while they are putting a two wires,
Now it went up.
Yeah, because to me, that would really take it to the next level.
Yeah,
is
absolutely.
To bring the
One other thing is they need to stabilize this impeller, I can tell you. Every time we are moving, it moves a lot.
Yeah.
Moves a lot.
But at the same time, the
you
another
mean
device
better,
PHP.
Better anchoring, huh?
Yep.
Yeah, so that it just stays or maybe something anchoring here that comes with the.
Samin, what were you mentioning about?
No, but other device, PHP, percutaneous heart pump of St. Jude's, which is taken up by Abbott with the Shield 2 trial, which was halted because of the device malfunction. Which actually had some other issues also, but they have made some changes and they expect to start the trial of the PHP device because we definitely need another device, comparatively, and we need to see where we are, and that hopefully will be available will in the trial format in next few months.
What size access does that?
Actually, that is even bigger. That's a 14 French.
Right.
That's even bigger than, so it's a CP basically. And now actually there's a lot of push now using these devices by axillary approach, percutaneous axillary approach, because we know 20-25% of the patient, we cannot go from the groin. So large bore axillary access is the new, the technique which is evolving, and rather than going to the whether you know the vena cava approach that you puncture from the vena cava going into the aorta.
So axillary or jumbo radial approach.
Yeah. You want to go there? So now we have put a, we'll see what wire you're using.
This is a fielder. So with the fielder, we went, I went to the circ.
Okay. So while we are trying to select in what do you want to do, which technique now, which balloons and so.
So we have a 3-5. I was just thinking 3-5 will be okay, or do you think we need a, you know, angioscalp or a flexstone for the circ?
I will go with the 4-ohm flexstone. The circ you can use. I think both places you can use a 4-ohm flexstone.
Okay, 4-ohm flexstone.
Yeah. Okay, while we are getting ready, so let's go to the second point, which is update in transradial intervention in the United States. And
which
basically,
one?
very nice editorial by Sunil Rao, who was part of our 100th webcast celebration here, had put it together that milestones of the transradial intervention over past 25 years, starting with the first trial of the safe PCI, and further now trying to find out some issues with the radial and going forward. Because clearly, that despite repeated trials showing benefit of transradial intervention, which we all know, the meta-analysis have shown clear benefit of lower mortality and lower vascular complication with the transradial versus transfemoral in all the randomized trial. We are still lacking that how many patients are truly getting it. Now, there are various reasons for it. The basically training, the people are worried about radiation exposure, crossover, so and so forth. And that actually had led to the class one guideline for the European. We are still behind with the 2A. And overall, transradial in STEMI patients, where the real benefit of the mortality comes, is used in 25% of cases.
Okay.
Yeah, in 25% of cases. Let's record everything we show in one second. So now question is what they showed in this paper from ACC-NCDR, that all the, what is the difference? What is the difference from the operator to institution? Because use of radial could be anywhere from, you can see here, from 1 to 2.5% to more than 50 plus percent. You can see the dark blue in the United States. So there is a lot of regional variation of the transradial access or transradial PCI, which we call intervention TRI or TRA for STEMI, based on the hospital referral region. They go to various factors, the transradial versus transfemoral, and they put it together actually very nicely in this clustering based on the operator and then clustering based on the hospital. Now you can see here that clearly the female gender is, we try to go more femoral, and we know because that's where biggest benefit occurred probably. There should be radial. And same thing with the younger the age, more radials are being done, not in the old patient. And there is a cutoff that like 75 years of age and above, those patients should get the left radial rather than right radial. So clearly, patient who is obese, PVD, get the radial intervention. Patient anemic, but many of these criteria you can see on the left of it, and that basically is that what your training is all about. So clearly, that operators, and then so the people who are trained before 2012, you can say old guys, old trainees, they are using more femoral compared to the younger generation, which is using more radial intervention. Now, what about the hospital? So hospital about the similar kind what was shown, but more often that the urban, rural versus urban, that urban centers using more transradial intervention, higher the volume, higher the radial intervention, and so forth. And patients with a renal disease, it is felt that transfemoral is better than transradial. So this is actually puts it together in their the central illustration. There could be a variation from 8.74 fold in transradial access for STEMI PCI based on the operator, and institution almost 5-fold. So big variation. So there is a lot of room to grow. And this is the whole case that while it is going up, use of transradial, but the findings suggest an ongoing opportunity to standardize STEMI care. Clearly, you can see the compared to UK, which is on the left side, BCIS, the 25% they reached in 2011. And we got 25% now in 2016, 6-year delay. Question is why we are so lagging behind? Is it, I say the simple maybe, can't teach old dog the new tricks. Maybe people who are right now still big interventional volume is by the old people. and they don't want to go to the newer approach. But I think it's a put system in place. There's clearly a benefit of radial intervention as had been shown. At the same time, there are a few of them. There are some issues coming up in terms of disability of the radial axis causing the hand dysfunction. And do you go through the superficial and the deep palmar arch? And clearly, that they actually, the data support that there is no need to do a modified Allen or Barbo test because it does not correlate with overall the patency of the radial artery. And so clearly, as you can see here, that 46% of the patients have superficial palmar arch incompleteness and so. So, and they clearly, so I think we do routinely, but may not be necessary. But more importantly, even if you have some of this occlusion, they do not cause any hand dysfunction. There's another data in terms of basically the recovery of the vascular, I would say the radial artery in terms of response, and has been shown that you really, on 20% of cases, you have a problem with the radial by intimal tear or medial dissection, as seen by the OCT, and of course, you lose the vasodilatation, flow-mediated or nitrate-mediated vasodilatation, those we catheterize. So clearly, those will not be a good cases for radial artery conduit when patient goes for surgery, and they have seen some data on the progenitor cells and so on and so forth. So transradial cardiac catheterization causes endothelial denudation, vascular injury, and vasomotor dysfunction that recover over 12 weeks. Recovery of vascular function does not appear to be dependent on the mobilization or function of the endothelial progenitor cells. So clearly, the radiation issue is ongoing. But I think the one group I would say where it should be used is the patient with acute coronary syndrome. We are still far behind with about 25-30% range, while that number is already 68-70% in rest of the world. Okay, and tell us quickly around before you go in.
We just did a cutting balloon, 4-0 into the LAD, 4-0 into the circ.
Okay.
Now, we think the proximal circ lesion looks bad, so the cutting balloon would not go in there. So, we're just going with the 3-5 balloon, which we already had. This has to be covered. The stent has to cover this proximal circ lesion.
You think that probably happened because of the angulation?
No, was there. About a 30-50% lesion was there all the time.
Right.
Our plan was, let's leave it alone, not get in there, but it's looking bad.
Show that picture after the LAD stenting, I mean LAD cutting balloon.
So, if you see, good. Not here, just want to show the initial, okay,
circumflex,
here.
Yeah.
Yes. Don't see it here.
Yeah, you see a little,
see there?
Yeah. Okay.
This is the same view we have.
Right. Yeah.
Okay, go up here.
In that view, the only thing I thought for clear was how severe the left main was. That looked.
Okay.
Sameen, what down. Is, if I was to ask your fellows who complete each year, are they planning to use more femoral or transradial?
Transradial. Now at Sinai, we have made it a quality QA. Sorry, you have to pull back a little bit.
Yeah.
Slowly go. Yeah, that we have made a QA para. And I'll, the factor, the pullback a little more, it's going to slip again. Yeah, slow. Yeah. So that we reached the 33%. Now, see, we are about like 31.7. So, idea is that we need to do 30, at least one third of the cases. Because remember also, it's moving.
Yes, good. We're okay.
You want to do a cutting balloon and just go 3.5?
Yeah.
I think you have to open it, because remember you also have to avoid Kempow paradox, which we showed that you become too much radial, you have higher vascular complication. So I think you have to balance of both, but in my opinion, once you get about 40-50%, not 80%, go to the ostium.
We did further. All
go
that.
Go 1 second, I'll tell you which one.
Good.
Yeah, good. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, so there is beyond all the factors you mentioned, another very practical issue is patient preference.
Yeah.
What is the final verdict on that? Is the majority of the patients
prefer the, as per literature, the radial approach compared to femoral.
But and unless you have a study of the same patient having femoral versus radial, number one,
you cannot
patient
know
occupation,
sure.
number two, you cannot talk about it.
Yeah.
Right.
You have patients who say this, painful.
Most of
nobody
the
is talking about radial artery occlusion, the other pain they get because of. Carpal tunnel now.
Honest appraisal by the physician, I think most patients will go with that recommendation.
Take a picture now.
I think what you need to do is have a survey of every interventional cardiologist. ACC or SCAI should do it and ask them if they have an MI or they have a stable CAD, what is the route PCI they prefer?
Mm-hmm. Guide a little bit. I can tell you majority still will be the radial.
Yeah. No interventional cardiologist will tell do radial.
Something in the distal left main there?
Yeah, which is okay. So which we knew. So let's put two stents now.
Okay. Now what do you want? 4-0 into the circ?
Yeah.
3-5 into the
LED, no, is it possible to have one more picture with more caudal to it? To
no,
caudal
or epicranial? You don't see it.
Yeah, we didn't see it.
Okay. Okay, okay, 1 second.
Yeah, 1 second. Move the camera down. Let's see. Move. Yeah, that may be okay. Yeah, let's take it.
No, some overlap, see. But
go epicranial. Then epicranial.
No, only thing epicranial showed it the best.
Yeah. See that now there is a little dissection there, which is okay. So you need a longer stent in the circ.
4-0, I think was. I think 4-0 is too big. No, for the circ. Let's go 3-5.
Yep.
Magnification is 20.
Yeah,
five, so it's good.
Yeah, you want to, no, let's go the real 20. One. What we do?
Sameen, a very provoking thought which came as I listened to your presentation on the DAPT. You know, we are assuming, you know, when you're making a recommendation.
Let's get a 4-0.
Yeah.
A 4-0, what length you want to the circ though?
Yeah.
We take a 28?
Yeah.
4-0, 28 to the circ and then we go 3-5, right?
Yeah. 20 or 24 will be okay.
What are we doing technique?
mini crush was what you had.
Then we take a shorter. So we are saying the circ stent will be the one?
Yeah, 24. 24 and LED also you can use 4-0.
I think it will be too big. 24 to the circ? Oh, that way you want.
Yeah.
So you want the LED stent across?
Yeah.
Okay, 4-0. No, 28 will be too long. Then the other one and 20.
And 20, yeah. Go to the last picture.
Yeah. So we are going.
Yeah, this is good.
Yeah.
This is a
4-0, 20 to the LED and 24 to the circ.
Sir, good.
Both 4-0s.
Yeah, both 4-0. Yeah, okay. Very large vessels.
So, Sameen.
Yeah, you're saying something. Yeah.
Yeah, when you talk about duration on the DAPT and the recommendation made, all the DAPT score and complex lesion definition.
Yes.
One is assuming that the angiographic result has been pristine with the adequate stent expansion, which is often not the case.
Yeah, no, that is true. So key is, these are the patients who have no procedural complication. And we also know that once you have suboptimal results, these agents should be given one more stronger antiplatelet therapy and for longer duration. Sir,
open 20 first. We'll keep it here. What is that? 24 open.
Yep.
I think both particularly the twilight will shed so much more light exactly as the name of the trial is suggesting.
Yeah, but the only problem is that the results of the global leaders will be available before, and that is a bigger trial of 16,000 or 20,000 patients.
Right.
And there it's only for 1 month. So Roxana Mehran is the PI of the twilight, and I just said that it may be a little mute point if they show that 1 month is good enough. So, but clearly there is a little difference.
Don't connect.
And the difference basically was that in patients with the global freedom, the patients there was a differentiation based on the acute coronary syndrome, and while the trial, the twilight is a trial of non-acute coronary syndrome but complex lesion morphology.
Anu, continue taking us stepwise through the technique here.
I went 4-0, 24 into the circ.
I encourage people to open the app.
Yes. Go.
So you have the 4-0.
Side branch is the circ, so I have 4-0, 24 into the circ, and now we are going 4-0, 20 from left main to LED.
Got it.
We have the feeder wire in the circ, and then we have the run through in the LAD.
And both are PROMAS?
Both are PROMAS.
And you know that all both the Zions as well as the Synergy have that trial ongoing, evolved DAPT and short DAPT, answering that question that can you decrease, particularly patients who are high risk for bleeding, can you decrease the duration to 3 months?
Right.
Rather than standard 12 months. And I know there are some small studies actually using Endeavor and Resolute have shown that maybe 1 month is good enough. Although 1 month trials are not happening in United States yet.
See, this is like slipping every time.
Anu, yeah, more description. Exactly, I was going to ask you that point. So much manipulation is being required with the guide here to position them exactly right.
Yeah, but that is the part of it. You know, this is because once you have the stent,
good enough position there for the.
No, it's a lot of crush. Let's take a picture. Lot of crush of the circ. It's not a mini crush, macro crush here.
Okay. So advance?
Advance the circ a little bit, right?
Circ, yeah.
So we have to be very careful then the.
So not even should be the mini crush, should be the micro crush or nano crush.
Micro.
Yeah, I like the word crush. Nano here.
Nano is better word.
Some dye.
Go a little more.
Okay, ready? Now this is better now. Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
Okay. Go up with the circ.
Go.
Good.
And how high are you? Expanded 16, very nicely?
16.
Okay.
Negative. Go up again.
Go up again.
And this is if somebody was opening the
now we are looking at the hemodynamics. Show the hemo.
Bifurcated app, you would see exactly these steps?
100%.
Yes.
Okay.
You can open it on your iPad. iPhone.
I have recommended that. I believe this.
Okay,
will
now we will say take out the balloon, take out the wire, take a picture, make sure there is no distal edge dissection. Then you proceed with the sear. Now this is a little tricky in the sense everything may come out. And every time we are showing a caudal picture, not the cranial picture in our bifurcated app. Okay, little dye. We say what we say is show dye, make sure there's no distal edge dissection.
For the circumflex.
For the circumflex, which looks good.
Good.
So we're taking out the wire. Exactly this is the step. And then we say you go up with your LAD. Okay.
Okay.
With nano crushing of the circ.
Wait. I need to see.
Little dye. Good.
Okay, go up. Now we need a 4.5 to the left main, right? When we go up?
Pot. Yeah, 4.58 high pressure balloon. So I'm putting only 14 here because the LED is 3.75.
Now we recross. Yeah. We mention if you have difficulty in recrossing, then you consider pot.
Mm-hmm. But I think most of the people are doing it because
one of the. No, it is extra step. You have to give both options. They want to do extra step versus.
Take this one out.
Not that you need it all the time.
Sameen, another year coming to an end. What has been the highlights of 2017 in interventional cardiology?
Well, I mean, from our point of view, there have been a lot for intervention. I think one, we saw the death of our bioabsorbable technology. Bioerodible polymers really have.
So that's negative progress.
Negative. But biodegradable polymer have shown very positive with Orsiro recently beat Zions in the BioFlow 5 trial. So I think the field year ahead will come with the biodegradable polymers.
You want to take a picture?
Yeah. Yeah, good.
How do you rate it in terms of advances in structural heart?
Growth has been happening. That kind of the tower continues to evolve into a lower risk situation, but is the mitral. As you saw in the TCT, there were like 30 presentations of the different mitral valve TMVR trials showing in various stages of their development. That's where I think the future is going to go in various situations. So while aortic kind of, I would not say it has plateaued, but it basically has now just had to be refinement more so for the newer valve coming. It's more so the studies have been done, but existing valve, both Evolute as well as the Sapien 3, being studied in the low-risk cases. Partner 3 trial has been completed as of October, 2 months, and they have the one-year endpoint, and they feel that maybe you want a new wire, that they feel that AHA of 2018, if everything goes well, we could have a low-risk approval for the tower in by presentation of the Partner 3 trial. There is no question that it will be as good, because we know that every studies have shown, including the Notion trial of the low risk with a 300 plus patient, 4 year follow up, and so on and so forth. So clearly that it just has to, we had to prove it that in United States also. And you know, the 1 year endpoint of the Partner 3 trial was not only death and stroke, it was also the rehospitalization. Because that is one important issue, that if you prevent rehospitalization, which is the biggest expense in United States compared to out of the country where hospitalization is cheaper, but USA is like almost $5,000 a day. So even decreasing rehospitalization will be very important. Similar is the co-op trial, which is the trial for the functional mitral regurg, has completed. It's a 2 year endpoint of repeat hospitalization in these patients with a functional mitral regurgitation. And the new devices, many of them are being studied. So I think real growth has been on sides of structure, and so also the ASD, that now the ASD closure, a few papers in NEJM talking about PFO closures, and particularly for various events. So I think that field is going to explode also. The renal denervation is coming back with a different, with the moderate hypertension patients. And so but a lot new, I think, has given us insight into the upcoming interventional cardiology techniques and devices.
That is such a wonderful perspective you provided for the year. Clearly, of course, as we evaluate, it's not surprising the interest in transmitral, because the approaches are so many.
Yes.
All right, so that was the new wire. I was watching carefully how the old wire was behaving.
2012 first.
Let's try.
Yeah, 2012, right?
Mm.
Yeah,
so in the bifurcate app, now we will say you go with the...
No, 408 will not go. 408 will not go. You think you want to try?
Why did you take 8? 8 can never be used in a... 12, at least 12 we need.
What is that? This is 4.5. No, this is for proximal. We are not open anything for the side branch. Give us a 2012 compliant balloon, and then
you don't want to try? The other one will go? Okay.
Which one now? No, used balloon will not go.
Not used, non-used balloon.
But we don't have not used yet.
Then open. Four.
Yeah. So question is, that should we try just to show that whether 4-0 non-compliant 4-0 will go?
4-0 what you have? 12.
12?
High pressure balloon.
You want to try that first?
Yes.
To show?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's what we tell in... or bifurcate.
No, what did you say in the bifurcation, in this situation?
In this situation, we always say try with, for the non-left main, we always say go with the compliant balloon to the side branch and the non-compliant to the main vessel. For the left main is always non-compliant, okay. Both sides. If it does not go, then you go with the 2-0 balloon or pot.
Sameen, follow-up question for you. Based on your discussions today, what is depth for this patient? Straight away 12 months.
Low, 12 months, or even because of left main and
longer.
Low EF, longer.
Because this patient has bifurcation, 2 stent, and low EF. So I think this one, we give it longer.
To me, the good part is people are following closely.
Okay. Yep. See, according to bifurcate app, this is working.
Okay, now you want to put a balloon in the main vessel yet or no?
You want 4-5, right?
Yeah, we have it.
You go 4-5? Because LED is not 4-5. Left main is.
Okay. Yeah, but just
okay,
we can 8. Open a little bit.
8. Open.
Yeah.
Whatever you have.
Yeah.
So, one of the more striking moments I had this morning was looking at your board, and both of you have 19 cases tonight. You're definitely not planning
That's
to
okay.
go home.
Yeah, that's, we don't talk about
19 cases each.
Yeah, but what happened is, because we have been all, away, and so we accumulated.
No, yeah, because no, that's not the reason. Yeah. Nobody wants Thursday, Friday. Nobody wants to come. Yeah. They all are getting ready for Christmas. So
but this is that's the reason. Just amazing. I am assuming that 19 cases do not have complexity like this.
Well, actually, one patient already has a balloon pump.
Right. Okay.
Yeah, and but keep it there.
Okay.
Let's open this.
Just a tribute to the teamwork and the contribution of the nursing staff, the cath lab technicians, the fellows. This is as good a well-oiled machinery I have ever seen.
I will tell you even a better of that.
Tell me.
A few weeks ago, one of the patients passing by in front of that board and asked the nurse at 5 p.m. You pull the main also.
Main
pull back. Pull back a little bit, main.
Yeah.
So ask the nurse. The nurse actually just has come off the orientation. Mm-hmm. She asked the nurse, you have a lot of cases.
Uh-huh.
When do you end? When do you finish? You know, the answer was, when all cases will be done.
Yeah.
Nothing that will be midnight or my shift, nothing. When cases will be done.
And just to make it simpler for yourself, on your hardest day, you also fast.
Yeah.
Okay. Quite an accomplishment.
These cases, we need God a little on our side.
You do. Patient dealing hemodynamically fine.
So far, see this. This is the one. Show the hemodynamic. Now the blood pressure goes down to about 80 with this case balloon. Right?
Okay, now
quickly. Last.
Wait.
Augmentation still more than 2?
Yes.
At level 9?
This is the last.
The thing is, go.
A low pressure.
Go. Good.
You can go a little more, 14. Good. And I'm at 12. Good. Sine and out.
Done.
Okay. See to believe it.
Tell the OR, get ready. I don't think she knows. Or number.
Very good. Very impressive how the entire hardware came out.
Purposefully removed.
Yeah. And when does the impella come out?
Now. If everything looks good, we'll take it out and our well-trained fellows will close the groin. We have the pre-close already there.
Mm-hmm.
Good. Right?
Sine. All right.
Perfect conclusion to 2017.
Good. Take one picture more.
This was not an easy case, and I am sure our viewers are going to pick up many teaching points of excellence. Anu, another superb endeavor here.
Beautiful.
Everything looks just fine.
Yeah. All right, so to conclude, we go to our take-home messages. There are numerous publications supporting the long-term DAPT in patients with complex PCI. Hence, in patients with complex lesions with high DAPT score of 2, long-term DAPT 3 years plus is appropriate. Now, people ask, what will happen in 3 years? Why not longer? Well, very simple, because we didn't do any trial. Trials stopped at 3 years. So, no matter what it was, Pegasus, DAPT, everything was for 2.5 to 3 years. So, it's appropriate. Of course, patients at high bleeding risk, long DAPT should be avoided even after the complex PCI. Second, there is a significant lag in transradial access adoption in the US, despite numerous trials showing unequivocal benefit in reducing mortality and vascular complication, especially in ACS-MI patients. There are some caution of TRA about radial patency, hand function, and radiation exposure. But with increasing experience, all these concerns could be mitigated. I think that's the right thing to do, go up on the radiation, the radial access. I would say that once anywhere between 30 to 50% should be the threshold. So three questions quickly. Following lesion features constitute complex lesion favorable for prolonged DAPT, except unprotected left main, bifurcation lesion, vein graft lesion, CTO, lesion length less than 30 millimeter. We have spoken about it. Second, DAPT score includes the following factors, except left main lesion, stent size less than 3 millimeter, vein graft lesion, prior MI or PCI, LVEF less than 30%. And lastly, the latest NCDR data showed what percent of the STEMI cases are being done via transradial access in the USA. 50%, 40%, 30%, 20 to 30, and less than 20, which are very clear with our discussion. Now, Impella is being removed, and we end our today's webcast 102.
Sameen, congratulations to you, to Anu, to your staff. 12 exceptional cases for 2017. To our viewers, Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. We'll see you on January 16th for case 103.